بسم الله. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الصلاة والسلام على رسول الله أما بعد. First of all, I'd like to welcome everybody, the brothers and sisters, for attending this event, and inshallah, making it a success. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, wherever you are, death will find you out, even if you are in the towers built up strong and high. Now the reference on the actual poster mentions Surah An-Nisa verse 11, which is actually Surah An-Nisa verse 75, just a clarification there. And the title of the talk is Death, Destroyer of Pleasures. And alhamdulillah, we have today with us a very special guest. We are honored with a special guest, Abu Usama Dahabi. And inshallah, he will be doing this talk. And without any further delay, I will pass it over to him.
Before we begin, just want to carry on very quickly a dhikr connected to the khutbah of Jum'ah today. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was traveling with his companions after a campaign of al-jihad fi sabilillah, the real jihad and not fasad that some people were creating for the ummah and kuffar today. He became tired because he's a human being. He's from the Bashar, so he became tired. And his companions were tired. If he was from the Nur of Allah, he would have never become tired. He would have never gone to sleep. And they said that when he used to sleep, he used to snore, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Nur of Allah doesn't snore, the Nur of Allah doesn't sleep. He had Rahman, his companions, when they became tired as well. And he said, we're going to rest right here. So some of the companions, while resting, looking for a place to rest, some of them went over there. Some of them went over there. Some of them went over there. Some went over there. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stuck his head out and he saw their situation. He said to those companions, radiallahu anhu, ma li arakum izin. Inna tafarrutukum fi hadhihi. الشعاب والبودية إنما ذلك من الشيطان. He said, why is it that I see you, my companions, all over the place? You over there, over there, over there, over there. He said, verily this distribution, this scattered nature that you're sitting, in all over the place, he said, that's from the shaytan. The narrator of the hadith that's in Abu Dawood, the Sunan of Abu Dawood, his name is Kunya Abu Tha'lab al-Khushani radiallahu anhu. He said, after the companions heard the Prophet say that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they never came together, except that if you threw the blanket out, the blanket wouldn't hit the floor. From the Sunnah Ikhwani in our religion, that causes unity and causes us to be able to deal with each other and tolerate each other, from the many practical Sunnahs is, in this masjid, when there is the khutbah of al-jum'ah or any lesson, not to sit the way we're sitting. This is against the sunnah. He said, this is from the shaytan, that he sit over there, he sit over there, he sit over there, he sit over there, he sit over there. And in the case of the companions, it was a mundane issue. They just wanted to find a nice place where he can go and rest. The Nabi said, that's from the shaytan. So the way we get unity in al-Islam is by being practical, following the sunnah. It's not getting a microphone or bullhorn and going out in the street saying, unity, 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 jihad, jihad, khilafah, khilafah. That's not how these issues come back. These issues come back by us practicing the everyday, normal, practical sunnahs. Getting feet to feet and shoulder to shoulder in the salah helps me to tolerate this brother and to tolerate the other guy. Five times a day. For Fajr, I'm between him and him. For Salat al-Dhuhr, I'm between him and him. For Salat al-Asr, him and him. And it's like that every day of the year. It makes me an individual who I can tolerate my Muslim. As so he said way over there, and he's way over there, it's the me, myself, and I culture. So I want to explain that hadith, share that hadith, and I hope that we can be like those companions, radiallahu anhu, when they heard the hadith, None of them said, it's just a sunnah. It's just a sunnah. It's not the Quran. It's not the Quran. So if you're an individual who doesn't have a back problem, if you're old and you have a back problem, no problem. You can sit on a wall. You sit there. Or if you think the wall is going to fall over, then you sit there. But other than that, coming close together, ikhwani, and not being far away is from the sunnah of the Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in this masjid and other than this masjid. Concerning the issue that we are going to deal with today, the issue of death, there are many Islamic organizations today, many of which claim that they're calling to the sunnah, that when they invite people to the masjid or to their program, they like to give generic titles, generic talks, talks that there's no ikhtilaf about. And that's good. There's nothing wrong with that, because we shouldn't want to see the Muslims in a perpetual state of ikhtilaf and fighting. So there's certain talks that we find people giving, like the Dajjal, like the major signs of Yawm al-Qiyamah. There shouldn't be ikhtilaf about these issues. They're generic. So if a person comes and he curses the companions, he can come, listen to the talk, and leave, and he still curses the companions. If a person comes, he's believing that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't die, nor of Allah, hazir, nazir, he could come and he can leave and stay the same way. Many topics are like that, that we hear the people calling to. They're supposed to be calling to the sunnah. This issue about death, in actuality, it's one of those issues we see people consider to be generic, when in reality it's not generic. It's not generic. It is from the usul of al-Islam, and it's from the usul of the life of every individual, because as the ayah said in the Quran, kullu nafsin dha'iqatul maut. It is important for many reasons to show you that it's not generic. Some organization, dawah organization, we don't want to make people angry, so everything is ikhtilaf, is ikhtilaf. Don't worry, you have your side, you have your side, ikhtilaf. Although the issue is clear, ikhtilaf, so that people don't get upset. This issue is not one of those issues. This issue is from the asul of al-Islam, because everybody's gonna die. And there are some aspects of death that we have to understand. It's not generic, because the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to command his companions to think about death a lot. It was from his sunnah. He told the people in an authentic hadith, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi tasleemun kathira akthiru min dhikri hadha al-adhat. Remember a lot, remind yourselves a lot, think a lot, contemplate a lot about the destroyer of the pleasures. They said, what is the destroyer of the pleasures, Ya Rasulullah? He said, death. And that's because if an individual is living his life and he's not cognizant, he's negligent, he's just going around collecting his dunya, he's going around, he's not thinking. If he thinks about death, he'll slow down or put the brakes on, pump the brakes, and he relaxes and he starts to get himself together if he thought about death. Especially when someone dies who's close to us, it makes a person start to think about the spectacle of death and the reality. And although we don't like death, although we don't like it, it is actually a ni'mah when people die who are around us, who we know. And we're gonna come to that, inshallah. One of the benefits of it is it causes a person to take it easy. And for the one who has a lot of problems as well, going through a lot of drama, a lot of problems, as long as he's not dead, he knows he has a chance. I don't care how many people he owes money to. They're about to foreclose on his property. They're going to take his car. I don't care how many people he owes money to. What his problem is, if you're not dead, it's not that bad. But once you die and you check out, it's done. Now you're in trouble. So the Nabi used to tell the people a lot, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He used to remind them on a daily basis. He told the people about the salat. Sallu salat muwadda'a fa'innahu hariyun li'an yuhsin al-mar salatu. When you get up and pray, pray the prayer of a man who is about to die. It's your last prayer you're going to pray. For verily, if a person approached prayer like that, he said, it will make him pray correctly. In America, if they're going to execute you, however they're gonna do it, put you in that gas chamber, electric shock, shoot you, whatever they're gonna do, those kuffar, they let you pray if you wanna pray. They say you make your last prayer. You want a priest? They let the priest come. You want a dinner? They give you the last meal. Whatever you want. It can be extravagant, whatever you want. They're going to provide it for you because they have that respect. You about to check out of this dunya, so you allowed your last prayer. If a Muslim was allowed to pray two rak'at, these are your last two rak'at. You're about to meet Allah. We're going to shoot you after this. Then the person is not going to pray the way we pray today. Get up for Fajr. No two rak'at for the sunnah. I'm just going to pray those two rak'at of Fajr real quick. Qul Allahu Ahad. Wal Asr. Jump back in the bed and that's it. I'm looking around and stuff like that about people. Not going to pray like that. So he used to tell them, pray the prayer of a man who's about to die. That was his way of telling you how to pray five times a day. Take your time before you pray and contemplate. If I were to die, this is my last prayer. No one knows if you're going to see Maghrib. Asr is the last prayer that you pray. You're going to pray that prayer in a special way. In addition to that, and lastly, how this should not be considered a mundane affair or a generic topic. This is a topic connected to the usul of our lives and our religion. It's not generic in that the scholars of Islam, the scholars of this masjid, this is a masjid of Ahlul Hadith, and every Muslim should be Ahlul Hadith. An Imam Abu Hanifa is an Imam of Ahlul Hadith. Al-Imam Abu Hanifa said, إِذَا صَحَّ الْحَدِيثُ فَهُوَ مَذْهَبِي. If the hadith is authentic, then that's my madhhab. If it's authentic, then that's my madhhab. And he would never, ever knowingly go against the hadith. Never. None of those imams were like that. Rahimahumullah ta'ala. The scholars of al-hadith of the past, who we take our religion from and who we pattern our lives after, inshallah, they used to write in all of those books of the Aqidah and the Minhaj of Ahl Sunnah, Ahl Hadith. All of those books, without any exception, they have in them from the Asul of the Sunnah, from the Asul of Al-Islam, is to believe in Munkar and Nakir, to believe in the Adab of the Qabr, to believe in those issues that are connected to Al-Mawt, like the Sirat, and so forth and so on. So again, Ikhwani, the scholars of Al-Islam, we raise them up. We don't worship them, but we raise them up. And we say, they're the best of this ummah. The ulama are the best of this ummah. So when they pay attention to an issue, it's worth our while, our effort, our time to also pay attention. And those scholars of the Sunnah used to write those kinds of books. Like the great Imam Al-Imam al-Sabuni, he has a book called Aqidah to Salaf, Ashab al-Hadith. The Aqidah of the pious predecessors, the people of Al-Hadith. And he brings in these issues that are connected to death. It is not a generic issue. It's from how to be a Muslim. Something that people need to know about, something that we need to learn, something that we need to be reminded of. This is what we're going to do today, inshallah. We have a lot of issues that we want to deal with. Hopefully we'll get through into all 10 of them. If not, we do the best that we can and maybe during the Q&A session, the other issues will be able to be tackled, dealt with, and discussed. At the top of the list, before we mention anything about death, I think the single most important thing to mention to you people at the top of the list is everybody is going to die except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some people may sit in the audience and say, Abu, that's basic fundamental information. You think so? There are some people who, whenever they meet you for the first time, they shake your hand for the first time, and they don't shake your hand like this, which is a reward, and it's from the sunnah. If two Muslims meet each other and they shake hands, this is ibadah. The Prophet said that their sins fall off each other the way the leaves fall off a tree. And the Prophet would never let that man's hand go until he let his hand go. This person from our ummah, when he meets you for the first time, he grabs your hand and he does like this, looking for your thumb. He does that because he believes Al-Khidr, who was with Musa, is still living and walking around in the earth. And the sign that he's Khidr is he doesn't have a thumb. So he doesn't know and he doesn't understand that Khidr is dead. Khidr died, as we're going to explain to you. So at the top of the list, The only one who doesn't die is Allah Azza wa Jalla. Any new Muslims in this masjid reverse, don't get this point twisted as some people misunderstand. Allah mentioned in the Quran, وَكُلُّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَا فَانْ وَيَبْقَى وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ ذُو الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ. Everyone who is on this earth is going to perish. And the only one who will remain is the countenance of the face of your Lord. ذُو الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, كُلُّ شَيْءٍ هَالِكٍ إِلَّا وَجْهُهُ. Everything is going to be destroyed except Allah, the face of Allah. Allah told the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, تَوَكَّلْ عَلَى الْحَيِّ الَّذِي لَا يَمُوتْ وَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِهِ. Ya Muhammad, rely on Allah al-Hayy, the one who lives forever and he never dies. Glorify him and praise his name. In the dua of the Nabi Ummat al-Islam, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from his many dua, he used to say, Allahumma laka aslamt وَبِكَ أَمَنْتْ إِلَىٰ أَنْ قَالْ أَنْتَ الْحَيِّ الَّذِي لَا يَمُوتْ وَالْجِنُّ وَالْإِنْسِ يَمُوتُونَ. Oh Allah, I embrace Islam, I submit myself to you alone, and I believe in you alone. You are the living who doesn't die, and all human beings and all jinn, they die. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, in that tremendous incident that has a lot of benefits in it, we'll only take the portion what we need from it. When the Prophet died, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he died, Umar radiallahu anhu was in the masjid threatening people with his sword. Anyone who says that, Rasulullah, he died, you're a munafiq, and I'm gonna kill you if I hear you saying it. Because no one says that, except he doesn't believe in Allah. That was the position of Umar. He said that Prophet Muhammad went to meet Allah the same way Musa went to meet Allah for all of those days, 40 days and 40 nights. If I hear anyone saying that, I'm going to kill you. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu heard the news that the Nabi died. He came from where he was. He went into the house of the Nabi, the room of his daughter Aisha. The Prophet was there, dead, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Bakr kissed him on his forehead and smelt him. He said, you smell and taste as sweet in death as you did in life. Came out, Abu Bakr said that, Umar, calm down, sit down, take it easy. Stop talking, sit down. Umar wouldn't listen, he wasn't having it, because the spectacle of death overtook him. So those brothers who were practicing, when we attend the funerals and the janazah of our relatives who don't know the sunnah, don't start arguing on that day. When they do innovation and they do crazy things, try to manage it in the best way. If they don't want to listen, don't start arguing on that day. It's one of the worst things that you can do. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu left Umar. He didn't argue with him. He just went and he got on the minbar. He got on the second step. The Prophet used to get on the third step. No one ever stepped on that minbar during the life of the Nabi. Nobody except him. He was the only khatib in al-Madinah. He got on the second step. As soon as the people saw that, psychologically, in their DNA, Prophet Muhammad steps on the third step. That's what they saw their lives. Someone is on the second step, this is a sign. Umar radiallahu anhu said, when I saw him on the second step, I knew something was going on. He looked at Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr said, oh you people, whoever worshiped Muhammad, Muhammad is dead. And whoever worships Allah, Allah is living and he doesn't die. Not a single companion said anything to Abu Bakr's statement. There is this thing in Islam called al-ijma', the consensus. Something is halal or haram based upon ijma'. The Nabi says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لن تجتمع أمتي على ضلالته. My ummah will never agree on something that's wrong. You'll find some Muslims who say khamr is halal. Some Muslims who say gambling is halal. Some Muslims who try to say marijuana is a plant from the land and is pure and is natural. Some will say that. But not all Muslims are going to say that. It's impossible. Impossible. Some Muslims, they may say something that's crazy. But everybody is impossible. When Abu Bakr told the community, those companions, Muhammad is dead, not a single one said anything, which is a clear proof that is ijma, nobody can come and say, no, he's not dead. If you do that in an issue like this, you're going against the companions. You're going against the biggest, strongest possible ijma in the dunya. All of those companions, Ummatul Islam, every one of you, all of those companions, all of them, were the opinion, because of the position that Abu Bakr took on that day and other situations from the hadith of the Nabi, all of them were the opinion that Abu Bakr was the best of this ummah. And now here you come today saying that, no, he's not. He's a kafir. He's a homosexual. You went against the ijma of the best people of this ummah. So the point here is, the statement of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu goes to show the point, the first point, that the companions were of the opinion, every human being dies except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Before moving on to the next point, inshallah, for those practicing brothers who are giving dawah, you young brothers who have the fervor and you want to give dawah, listen, we have some relatives, people in this city who said that the Nabi never died. It's not permissible for us to excommunicate those people and make takfir of them. That's a shubha that they have. Umar radiallahu anhu said that the Prophet never died. He said that the Prophet didn't die at that point. You're going to say the one who says the Prophet didn't die is a kafir because it goes against Quran and Sunnah? It goes against the Quran and the Sunnah, but you have to talk to people. You have to try to raise and get off of them ignorance. It's a misunderstanding, just like Umar had a misunderstanding on that particular day. That's not to make it soft and easy that they're saying what they're saying. Because the difference between Umar and the people today is, when the dalil is brought to Umar, he's waqaf, he'll just take the dalil. When you bring the proof to the people today, they'll keep arguing. So Umar, he had a shubha, and our relatives, they have shubahat. They're ignorant, many of them are ignorant. They're being taught by people who are ignorant as well. And in addition to that, there are some ayat of the Quran and ahadith that they can understand it. They understand the wrong way. وَلَا تَحْسَبَنَّ الَّذِينَ قُتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتٍ بَلْ أَحْيَاءٍ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ يُرْزَقُونَ وَلَا تَقُلْ لِمَنْ يُقْتَلْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتٍ بَلْ أَحْيَاءٌ وَلَكَ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. Don't think the people who were dying were killed. فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. They were killed. فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. The ayah said they were killed. فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. Don't think that they're dead, but they are alive, and Allah is providing for them, the shuhada. Another ayah said, don't say that those who were killed, they were killed, fi sabila. Don't say that they're dead, but they are alive. You just don't know about it. They have those ayah. The Prophet said about the anbiya, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-anbiya fi quburihim yusallud. The prophets are in their graves, and they are praying. That's what the Nabi says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They're praying in their graves. Allah Ta'ala's Nabi told us, today is Friday. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna lillahi malaikatan sayyahin yuballighuni min ummati as-salam. Allah has some angels flying around. They're wazifa, mas'uliyah, they're flying around. They hear the salams of my community upon me when they say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Those angels take the salam and they give it to the Nabi, and he's allowed to listen to those salam. So our relatives have those types of ayat and ahadith. We say, before moving on to the next point, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he died, but he is not dead. He died sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but he is not dead. But that's not something that's peculiar or special to him. The other prophets, they died, and they're not dead. Your grandmother, grandfather, great-grandmother, great-grandfather, they died, but they're not dead. Fir'aun is an enemy of al-Islam. He died, and he's not dead. Allah said about Fir'aun in an ayat that the scholars of Islam of the Sunnah use to show and to prove the adab of the qabr. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in this ayat, النَّارُ يُعْرَدُونَ عَلَيْهَا غَدُوًا وَعَشِيًّا وَيَوْمَ تَقُومُ السَّاعَةَ أَدْخِلُوا آلِ فِرْعَوْنَ عَذَابَ أَشَدَّ الْعَذَابِ. Every morning and every evening, Pharaoh and his people are being exposed to the hellfire. Pharaoh is in his grave. Every morning and every night, the hellfire is being showed to them, and they're in a state of terror. They're afraid every day since he's been dead. And Yom Kippur is going to be said, hey, Pharaoh, you and your people, go into the hellfire for grievous punishment. So, Ikhwani, every human being is going to die. But after dying, they're going to be in the life of a barzakh. And that's where the Nabi is, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. The next point, to reiterate, the Prophet died and every human being is going to die. As we mentioned, the brother mentioned the ayah, the beginning of the talk that's on this flyer. أَيْنَمَا تَكُونُوا يُدْرِكُمُ الْمَوْتِ وَلَوْ كُنْتُمْ فِي بُرُوجٍ مُشَيَّدًا. Wherever you are, death is going to catch up to you. Even if you try to seclude yourself and hide in some high tower, person tries to go all the way up in some tower, thinking that the Malik of al-Maut is not going to get you there. إِنَّ الْمَوْتَ الَّذِي تَفِرُّونَ مِنْهُ مُلَاقِيكُمْ. The death you're trying to escape is going to come to you. So that brings us to the next point. If everybody here knows that you're going to die, there are 2 points I want to advise you with. 2 points. If you know that you're going to die, Number one, don't connect yourself to any human being to the point where your happiness is based upon their existence. How many women do we know that came to the religion to marry the man? And then when the man died, she left Islam. How many people we know, they love someone so much that their happiness is based upon that? I love my sheikh so much. Whatever my sheikh says, that's what I'm going to do because I love him so much. The Salaf, they used to say, as long as a human being is living, fitna can come to him. He's on the sunnah today, he's an innovator tomorrow. He's a Muslim today, he's a kafir tomorrow. Don't make your religion. Whatever the sheikh says, that's what I say. My kid, my child, my baby. Abu Bakr, when he got on the minbar after the death of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he read an ayat of the Quran. وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا الرَّسُولُ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرَّسُولُ أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلَ انْقَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ وَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبْ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ فَلَنْ يَضُرَّ اللَّهَ شَيْئًا وَسَيَجْزِي اللَّهُ الشَّاكِرِينَ. Listen to this ayah. At that time, he said Muhammad is only a messenger, like the messengers who went before you. You companions, you're living now. You're living. Allah said, if Muhammad dies or he is killed, would you people turn back on your religion and apostate and leave Islam because he's no longer here? Allah is here. Allah is the one we worship. The scholars of the past in the 50s, the scholars of the Sunnah, when the Orientalists used to write about Islam and they would describe the Muslims as Muhammadans, the scholars of the Sunnah said, don't call us Muhammadans. We're not Muhammadans. We're Muslims. We accepted and embraced Islam for Allah, not Muhammad. We shouldn't call Christians Christians. We should call them Nasara, the way Allah called them in the Quran and the Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As for connection to Christ, they have no real connection to him at all. So the point is, if Muhammad is killed or if he dies, will you reject your religion and apostate? And anyone who does that, he doesn't harm Allah one bit, and Allah will reward the shakirin. That goes to show. Do not connect yourself to any human being, your mother, your wife. Everybody here. He experienced somebody dying. Everybody here. Look what the Nabi said that Jibril said to him. He said that Jibril came to me. And Jibril said to me, Ya Muhammad, عِشْ مَا شِدَّ فَإِنَّكَ مَيِّتْ وَأَحْبِبْ مَنْ شِدْ فَإِنَّكَ مُفَارِقُهُ وَاصْنَعْ مَا شِدْ فَإِنَّكَ مُجْزِيٌ بِهِ. Hey Muhammad, live. Live however you want to live, because you're going to die. And love anybody you want to love, because you're going to separate from that person. Everybody here is going to be with people for a certain amount of time. When that time comes that they die, when you die, What are we going to do? That's one of the problems of the people of Jahiliyyah. They couldn't embrace. If someone died, they went crazy. They couldn't accept it. But in Islam, we have adab, how to behave and how to act when people die. When the Prophet said Ibrahim died, Usama ibn Zayd, he screamed out. He lost his cool and he screamed out. The Nabi quickly said, I'm free from this. I'm free of this action. And bara'atul juz'iyyah. I'm free of the action of this Muslim. I'm not free of the Muslim altogether, but this action. He killed someone, he did something, my son did something, my daughter did. I'm free of that action, but that's still my daughter, that's still my son, that's still my brother in Islam. And the Nabi didn't allow the people to go crazy like that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So don't connect yourself to any human being. We respect the scholars, ikhwani, but the scholars, they are like this light in this ceiling. The scholars are like the light. After Isha time, we're sitting here, and I'm reading the Quran, and we're giving a class of tafsir. In the nighttime, the lights go off. They shut off, they go off. We're in pitch darkness. We can't read the Quran because we can't see it. You turn the light back on, we can start reading the Quran again and giving the tafsir. The scholars are like that light. When they come on, they help us to understand the Quran and the Sunnah. But the light is not the goal and the objective. The goal and the objective is the Quran. So don't be of the people who say, but the Sheikh said, my madhab said, my imams, don't be like that. The second issue is, and we move on, second issue is, after all of this, it's not permissible for a Muslim to be in doubt. Did the Prophet die or did he not die? The Prophet died, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And to be persistent saying that he didn't die when clear evidences have been established and come to an individual, then at this time, a person may go outside of the fold of Islam for having takdhib, rejecting what Allah established. Allah said to the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَمَا جَعَلْنَا لِبَشْرٍ مِّن قَبْلِكَ الْخُلْدَ أَفَإِمِّتَ فَهُمُ الْخَالِدُونَ. Ya Muhammad, we never gave any human being perpetual life, ever. Someone lived forever. So if you were to die, do these people think that they're going to live forever? No human being lives forever. We go to the next point about death. Our aqidah tells us, the third point, ikhwani, ummat al-Islam, death is in the hands of Allah alone. This is why it's important to have the right aqidah. If you know that no one can cause you to live or die except Allah, you're not afraid of people. You young people were in school. Many times young people are easily influenced. His peers start smoking cigarettes, start smoking weed. He has to smoke weed because he doesn't want to stand out. The Nabi used to teach the young companions like Ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhu. Hey, if you ask Ibn Abbas, ask of Allah. And if you seek help, Ibn Abbas, seek help from Allah. And you have to know, Ibn Abbas, if all of the people came together for you or against you, they can't help or harm you except with what Allah told you to do or what Allah decreed upon you. That Muslim boy who has that right aqidah's father raises him like that, he's not one of those people who's going to be a yes boy. Just go because the crowd said. Why are you smoking? Smoking is bad for you. It hurts. It's nasty. It stinks. It's not cool. Why are you smoking? Everybody else is doing it. That's a dumb answer. That's for a person who doesn't think. So, point number three. Death is in the hands of Allah. And it's part of our aqidah. Tabarak alladhi biyadihi al-mawt. تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا. Praise be to Allah who in his hands is the dominion of everything. He is the one who created death and life to test you. If you go, and I want you young people to do this and try to go there with your parents if they're here. If you go to the YouTube and you put in the YouTube near-death experiences. Maybe in the time of Abu Lahab and Abu Jahl, maybe those people saw some incidents where it showed them life and death is in the hands of Allah. But for us today, 1,434 years after the Hijrah, 2013 today, What was a miracle for them yesterday is daily experiences in ayat, near-death experiences. The minivan, the van, it runs through the red light. You're gonna see it. It runs through the red light and it's going fast. This car over here has the green light. They start moving. There's a pedestrian walking across the street, minding his own business. He runs into the car and the minivan rolls over on the pedestrian. The middle of the van rolled over him. He fell down. It was just enough room for him not to get crushed by 8 tons of a car. And that's because life and death is from Allah. The bullet doesn't kill. Just as the medicine doesn't save. That's the aqidah of the Muslim. The bullet doesn't kill and the medicine doesn't save. The doctor doesn't save. Allah Ta'ala, He's the one who gives people shifa, and He's the one who causes people to die. So if a person died, don't be like the kuffar of Quraysh and curse time or be upset with Allah. Whoa, why? What was me? That's not our religion. وَإِنْ يَمْسَسْكَ اللَّهُ بِدُرٍ فَلَا كَاشِفَ لَهُ إِلَّا هُ. If any harm happened to you, no one can take it off except Allah. No one can make it happen. No one can take it off except Allah. Number 4, Ikhwani, concerning this issue of death and what we get in the Islamic narrative, is that it is not permissible for anybody here to want to die. It's haram for you to want to die. You have some problems. Those creditors, they on your back. You got divorce. You have some issues. You're depressed. You have some mental challenges. It's not going your way. You fail and everyone is against you, and your relatives and parents look at you and they're putting pressure on you and they see you as a failure and you want to die and you want to kill yourself. That's not in our religion. And it goes against the religion and the fitrah, the natural disposition, the way Allah created Bani Adam, all of them, kuffar, everybody, is that every human being should want to live. The proof of that is what happened with our father Adam when Iblis came to him. فَوَسْوَسَ إِلَيْهِ الشَّيْطَانِ قَالَ يَا آدَمْ هَلْ أَدُلُّكَ عَلَى شَدْرَةِ الْخُلْدِ وَمُلْكِ لَا يَبْلَى. Shaytan came to Adam and said, hey Adam, he whispered to him, evil. He said, Adam, should I not lead you to a tree that will give you eternal life? You'll never die. And you'll have a kingdom that won't decay. When Adam was put, that proposition was put for him, he said, I want to live forever. He went to the tree. It's the natural disposition of Bani Adam to have hayat and to cover up his nakedness. All of that story of what happened with Adam, it goes to show the fitrah of Bani Adam. The fitrah. His fitrah is natural disposition. He's got to make sins. He's been created to make sins. He's not perfect. He's not from the angels. And one of those aspects of his fitrah is to live forever, as long as possible. So it's not permissible for a person to want to kill himself or to be reckless. The Nabi said in an authentic hadith, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لا يتمنين أحدكم الموت لدر نزل به فإنه إن مات انقطع عمله وإنه لا يفيد وإنه لا يزيد المؤمن عمره إلا خيرا. If some bad thing happens to one of you, do not desire to die. For verily, if one of you dies, his action and his deeds are finished. And if the believer were to live, his life just brings upon good. Look around the room right now. If you want to know the best person in the room right now, the Nabi told us who the best person in the room is in a number of hadith. One that is connected to what we're saying right now is his statement, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, khayrukum man qala umruhu wa hasanu amalu. The best of you is the one who lived a long time and he had good deeds. You see these older people? You see that sheikh over there on the chair? Sheikh back there. You see that sheikh? Oh, in the back. The Nabi said about them, inshallah, من شاب شيبة في الإسلام كانت نورا له يوم القيامة. Anyone who grows up and he has white in Islam, يوم القيامة is going to be a nur. You young people, 17, 18, 19, 20, 25, The sheikh over there, he fasted 40 years already, Ramadan. He made more hajj than some of you in terms of your age. He made hajj more than 10 times. The kid is 11, 12, 13. He made hajj 15, 20 times. So we have to take care of the elders in this masjid. We advise our elders, hey, this is not the old country. This is not Mianpur. It's not Pakistan. This is not Libya. This is the UK. We have to address our youth in a way that they understand so they don't come crazy and radical and they don't leave our religion. But you younger people, we have to respect these elders who bought the building, who started it off, and so forth and so on. So there's a dual effort of cooperation, but the elders deserve a special concern for us youngsters. And that's because why? The older person in Islam, the older you get, the more chances you have. You're young, you're not even married. If you die, you're done. This man, if he dies, he has 5, 6, 7 children. And their children have children. He's dead and he's still gonna get rewarded and he's in his grave because he was the reason by Allah's permission for those children and grandchildren. You didn't get married yet. Which brings me to a critical issue about this for young people today. The radical Muslims in this country who are destroying themselves and destroying Islam. There's a hadith that the Nabi says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, من أحب لقاء الله أحب الله لقاءه ومن كره لقاء الله كره الله لقاءه. Pay attention, ikhwani. The hadith said, anyone who loves to meet Allah, Allah loves to meet him. And anyone who hates to meet Allah, Allah hates to meet him. Our mother Aisha, the narrator of that hadith, when she heard that hadith, she said, Ya Rasulullah, all of us hate to die. Because she understood from the hadith that you should want to die. You should want to meet Allah. She said, all of us hate to die. That doesn't mean we hate to meet Allah. Nobody wants to die. If what she said was wrong, the Prophet would have said, don't say that, that's wrong. She said, the hadith doesn't mean that. He said, the hadith doesn't mean that, Aisha. What the hadith means is, what it means is, when a person dies, after he dies, the two angels, Munkar and Nakir, comes to everybody. They sit them up. They say to them, who's your Lord? What's your religion? What did you have to say about that man? If he answered correctly, the two angels are going to say, look over there. He'll look to his left. He say, you see, that's the hellfire. That was your place. Your name is in that place in the hellfire. Everybody got a place for him in the hellfire right now. Everybody. He answered correctly. Look over there. That was your place. He said, whoa, that was your place. But Allah saved you. And you're not going to the hellfire. You answered correctly. So look over there. He'll look over there. That's your place in the Jannah. The man now is going to have a good time in the grave. It's going to be a rawdah from the Riyadh of Jannah. He's going to make a dua. Allahumma aqim as-sa'ah. Allahumma aqim as-sa'ah. Oh Allah, establish the hour. I want that. I want to meet you. Establish. So Allah wants to meet him. That's the meaning of the hadith. And the opposite holds true. The munafiq, kafir, who's your Lord? What's your religion? What did you say about that man? He doesn't know, he answers it wrong. When he answers it wrong, the angel said, ma talit wa ma darit. You didn't read and you didn't know your religion. That's what he's gonna say. You didn't read. You just were, oh, happy. My name is Ahmed Bilal. My name is Mustafa, and that's it. My mother, my father, Muslim, I'm from Pakistan. That's it. They're gonna say, you didn't, I'm not against Pakistan. You're from the Congo, you're from Sudan. You didn't read, you didn't take time out to learn your religion. What did you say, who's your Lord? I don't know, I don't know. What's your religion? I don't know, I don't know. What did you say about the man who came? His answer, I heard the people saying something, so I said what they said. Hazir, nazir, nur Allah, ilm al-ghayb. But did you learn? Can you prove that? Can you prove that? Or are you like the Christians who say, Isa is the son of Allah? That individual, in his grave, he's gonna be punished. So he makes a dua, oh Allah, don't establish the hour. I don't want that, don't establish. So that's the meaning of the hadith. The radical, extreme Muslims who want to recruit some of the youngsters who are ignorant, they wanna practice Islam, Hey, tell him, did you hear that the prophet said, whoever wants to meet Allah, Allah wants to meet him? Take this bomb and go over here and do this and do that. And he's understanding the hadith totally, absolutely wrong. Hadith didn't mean that. And that's why you young brothers, getting knowledge of your religion from balanced people who know the Kitab and the Sunnah is imperative. Imperative. Last thing that I want to mention about this point, because it is important. The hadith said, no one should desire to die. But we do have an ayat and an incident in the Quran where one of the awliya of Allah wanted to die. Anybody know who she was? Anybody know who she was? Maryam. She went, Allah Ta'ala decreed, because he can do everything. He gives life and death without any asbab, without any father. She became pregnant bi-idhnillah. When she went to have the baby, when she was having a baby, she said, قَالَتْ يَا لَيْتَنِي مِتُّ قَبْلَ هَذَا وَكُنْتُ نَسْيًا مَنْسِيًا. I wish I was dead before this would happen. And I was something that the people forgot about. And that's because she didn't want to be a person who was accused of zina. The Muslim girl today, driving up here for Salat just now, we see a young white girl and a young white boy and another white boy. The girl was dressed in a nasty way. She was just lying on the boy in the way that's their religion. They don't have hidayah. She was dressed very sexually. That's their religion. That's how they don't have hidayah. Their religion doesn't tell them that. Don't do that. This is not okay. Their religion doesn't. Their religion allows them to be liberal and say homosexuality is okay. It's a Christian country right here. The queen, she makes you a sir or a knight with the Bible, and this is a Christian country. They can take liberty and just take the story of Lot, Sodom and Gomorrah, and throw it away. In Islam, we're gonna say that's abomination. It's a heinous crime. It's a major sin. It's nasty. It's not natural. But we can't hurt those people and we can't harm those people. As for being shy about what's the position in Islam, do you know that some Muslims are saying that homosexuality is okay in Islam because in the Jannah, the men are going to have young boys as their slaves and servants? Where'd you get that tafsir from? Did Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, and Umar, did they say that? Then you can't say it. They didn't understand those ayahs in that way. That lady, Maryam, didn't want to go back to her people, and they said, you committed zina. She said, I wish I was dead before this happened, and that the people forgot about me. So we know, la yukallifullahu nafsan illa wus'aha. Allah doesn't burden anyone beyond his ability to handle the problem. But listen, there are some people who have some problems. It's not for you or me to be judgmental. A few years ago in Al-Iraq, on the day of the Eid, a 14-year-old Iraqi girl was raped by 4 American Marines. After raping the girl, one after another, they killed the girl. They were caught, and the only thing that happened to them is that they were court-martialed. We didn't hear the world jumping up and down because of that atrocity. The point here is, that girl had a father, she had uncles, she had brothers. That girl herself, if the person is raped, may Allah protect us from that. That girl may say, I wish I was dead before something like this happened. And as a Muslim, I can't say to that girl, don't say that. I don't know what she's going through. Her father, I don't know what her father's going through. He has honor. His daughter was raped. I can't judge him. So that shows the balance of Islam. The Prophet told us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if a person has to pray for death, if you have to hope for death, because something may happen, he said your dua should be, Allahumma ahyini in kanat al-hayat khayran li, wa tawaffani in kanat al-wafat khayran li. Oh Allah, if living is better for me, then cause me to live. And if dying is better for me, then cause me to die. But generally speaking, something is bothering you and something happened in your life, don't wish for death. Don't be negligent. Every Muslim should be trying to live as long as he possibly can live and trying to do good deeds while he lives. Another issue, ikhwani, in our religion. We're not talking about Judaism, and we're not talking about the religion of the Nasara or Sikhism. We're not talking about Buddhism, agnostics. We're not talking about that. We're talking about the Islamic narrative. Listen, concerning death, in Islam, there are two deaths and there are two lives. Everybody lives two times and everybody dies two times. In our religion, some things are just different from the way of the kuffar. Like, the night precedes the day in Islam. The new day, the new day, the new day. Al-Jum'ah, yesterday. Jum'ah started at Maghrib time yesterday. So you can read Surah Al-Kahf at Maghrib time. We're in the month of Sha'ban. We're waiting for Ramadan. After Salat al-Isha, tonight, we're gonna go look for the moon. When we see the new Hilal, the new moon, we say it's Ramadan because the night precedes the day in our religion. So we can't be of the people who are confused. Certain aspects of Islam go against what these people are saying. You can't be an individual who comes and puts their way over Islam. Now, I'm not telling you when you write a check, you're going to write a check to pay for something, you're going to put the 24th of Dhulqa'dah. I'm not telling you to do that. You're going to make the check messed up. I mean, you're living here. You have to put the 24th of March. You have to do that. But when Islam establishes something that goes against their way, what are you going to do? Apologize, start dancing, acquiescing? We have enough Islamic leaders who are like that, apologizing. Why are we always on the back foot, apologizing? What happened in Boston? What happened in Boston? When it happened, the so-called immigrant Muslims in America, Arabs, Pakistani, Asians, they were so quick to come to say, we're sorry. We feel bad about what happened. But relax, calm down. They didn't even know who did it yet, and you guys are apologizing. Now, if it turns out that Muslims really did that, and Muslims had something, I don't have to take responsibility for that. The Nabi freed himself from the screaming of Usama. I free myself from that action of that Muslim, but I don't have anything to do with that. My religion doesn't have anything to do with that. And also, the next day after that bombing, there was a bombing off in Iraq. 50 Muslims were killed. They were blown up. So why don't we have that same sensitivity? Why is it that 3-4 people died over? That was bad. Don't get it wrong what I'm saying. That was bad. What I'm saying is, when are we going to stop being apologetic? Always on the defensive. You young brothers, when our relatives came to this country, the EDL, the BNP, they used to chase people. It's not like that anymore. Ain't chasing nobody. We're not going anywhere. We were born here, we live here, we pay taxes. Stop apologizing. Just be balanced. So the point that we want to make here, the point, and I hope it's a clear point, is that something can happen to an individual. Something can happen to an individual where he gets in this situation and he gets confused and twisted. In our religion, two deaths and two lives. Anybody want to explain that to me? What are the two deaths and what are the two lives? Ummat al-Islam. That's our religion. Anybody want to tell me? Take a try. Take a stab at it. The Qadr? Everything is with the Qadr, man.
I think sleeping is...
We'll come to that. What does it mean, two deaths and two lives? Anybody? Sheikh. There's an ayah, two ayats actually, that Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran. Rabbana qalu rabbana amittana ithnatayn wa ahyaytana ithnatayn fa'tarafna bi dhunubina fa hal ila khuruj min sabil. That's an ayah that the kuffar in the hellfire will say, oh our Lord, you cause us to die twice and you cause us to live twice. So can we get out of this hellfire? Can we get out of this situation? So the ayat establishing two deaths and two lives. كيف تكفرون بالله وكنتم أمواتا فأحياكم ثم يميتكم ثم يحييكم ثم إليه ترجعون. How do you people disbelieve in Allah when you were dead and then he gave you life and then he caused you to die again and then he's going to raise you up again? So the question now is, what are those two deaths and what are those two lives?
We are alive now and we will have a life hereafter.
One of the lives is we're living right now. We're living right now. And then we're going to die and then we're going to live again. That's two lives and one death.
Before we were born,
this is the strongest opinion of the ulama in al-Islam, inshallah. Sheikh, where are you from?
I'm from Egypt, Sheikh.
Egypt, from Tahrir Square. May Allah help the Muslims. May Allah help the Muslims in Egypt. Ikhwani, as the Sheikh said, our brother, he said, in Islam, just as the night precedes the day, in Islam, death precedes the life. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, وَإِذْ أَخَذَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَنِي آدَمَ مِنْ ظُهُورِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ وَأَشْهَدُهُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ قَالُوا بَلَىٰ شَهِدْنَا أَن تَقُولُوا يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ Remember when your Lord created Adam and he took from the loins of Adam all of his descendants and Allah spread them out at Arafah and Allah said to all of Adam's children, am I not your Lord? All of them, Fir'aun, all of them say, yes, you are our Lord. We bear witness, you are our Lord. Allah says, so that you don't come Yawm al-Qiyam and say you didn't know about this. How many of you have been to Mecca? Put your hands up. If you made Umrah or Hajj, put your hand up. Hi, let me see. Okay. How many of you have not been to Mecca? Put your hands up. If you haven't been to Mecca, you're the majority, Masakin. Oh, Allah, help them to go to Mecca this year. Oh, Allah, give them the halal money to go to Mecca this year to make Umrah and Hajj on the Sunnah. Although you didn't go to Mecca, you have been there already. You're in Arafat already. It's from the ilm al-ghayb. The Prophet told us that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah put everybody there, all human beings, and he said to them, say la ilaha illallah, am I your Lord? And they said it, and then Allah put them back. Before putting them back, Allah Azza wa Jalla threw a light over them. The light hit some of them, it shone on them. The light was shining on them. And the light missed some of them. Those who the light hit them, they're gonna be from the believers in the Jannah. Those people the light didn't hit them, they're gonna be kuffar. It's already decreed, already written. We pray and hope that that light hit us and that Allah doesn't allow us to be of the people the light missed. So the scholars said that when Allah took the people out, put them back in, that's the death before they were created. And then they came out of their mother's wombs and then they died in this life and then they're going to be raised up, Yawm al-Qiyamah. Very quickly, ikhwani, because we only got through six now. Next point that we want to mention, from what we should understand as Muslims is, every single day you're dying, and someone mentioned that just now, that when you go to sleep at nighttime, this is the smaller death in al-Islam. Every day, it's an ayah. Kuffar of Quraysh, they believed in Allah. They believed in Allah the wrong way. The Kuffar of Quraysh, they believed in the Malaika. But they believed in the malaika the wrong way. They said that Allah married the jinn. He had a nikah with the jinn and the malaika were his daughters. But they believed in malaika. Kuffar Quraysh, they believed in some of the anbiya. They knew about Ibrahim and Ismail. They believed in some of them. But one thing they did not believe in is they did not believe in Yawm al-Qiyamah. They didn't believe in that. And the Prophet ﷺ knew by telling them there's Yawm al-Qiyamah after you die, he knew that they would find that ridiculous, absurd. And yet, he wasn't shy to call to his religion. He told them what Allah told him to tell them. Just because non-Muslims don't accept that, yes, Prophet Muhammad married Aisha at that age. That's how it goes. Yes, the Quran mentions that there is slavery, riq. It's in the Quran. Now, I don't say that we should start giving dawah and telling people about those issues. Don't start your dawah like that. But why is it that the Muslims come and they say, look, You people marry cousins, that's incest. Muhammad married a girl, she was 11 years old, 9 years old. The Muslim apologetic said, no, she wasn't 9. Really, it's in the books, you know, Bukhari, Hadith, but the number 1 was before the 9, it was 19, but the 1 fell off. They made a mistake. That's the explanation some of the people are giving. That's what happened. As a Muslim, that's what happened. Isa ibn Maryam, if he came back right now, and we know that he's Isa ibn Maryam, Rasulullah, the Kalima of Allah, the Ruh from Allah, if he came back right now, I'm sure every man in this masjid who has a young daughter, if Isa ibn Maryam said, I want to marry your daughter 7, 8 nights, none of us would hesitate about that. Because that's how we look at Muslims. As Muslims, that's how we look at the Anbiya. But the people, Nasara, Yahud, they don't have that cultivation and that type of iman. It's not in their religion, demanding it from them. Liberalism. Ala kulli. One of the dawah mechanisms that the Prophet used, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for Quraysh about death was to tell them every day you go to sleep, you die. It's the smaller death. Every day, you're 25, 22, 23, 27. For all of those years, you've died multiple times. Allahu yatawaffa al-anfus hina mawtiha wallati lam tamut inda nawmiha. Na? Fi manamiha. Allahu yatawaffa al-anfus hina mawtiha wallati lam tamut fi manamiha. Allah causes the lives. Allah causes people to die when it's time for them to die. Allah. And he causes people to die when they go to sleep. The Prophet said, "An-nawm akhul maut wa ahlul jannah la yamutun." Sleep is the brother of death. And the people of Jannah, they don't die. Meaning, they won't go to sleep, they won't die. Khalidina fiha abada. You go to Jannah, you're not going to sleep. It's perpetual. So the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from his sunnah, is when he used to wake up and when he used to go to sleep, he used to make dua that were indications of this. Alhamdulillah alladhi ahyana ba'dama amatana wa ilayhi nushur. That was his dua, one of the many dua. He wake up, all praise are due to Allah who caused us to live after we died last night. And to him is the return. So ikhwani, as Muslims, we should understand, if you go to sleep at nighttime, for an example, you should go to sleep, you should pay attention to some of those sunnahs that the Prophet taught us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like going to sleep with wudu. Because if you die in your sleep, you die in the fitrah. Going to sleep saying the Sayyid al-Istighfar. Going to sleep saying different dua that he taught, al-Bura ibn Azib. He told him, if you say this dua, ya Bura, if you die, you're going to go to Jannah. Anybody who says it's going to go to Jannah. Anyone who says it when he wakes up, it's going to go to Jannah. And all of those dua, they have indications of this very point. The last point that we're going to mention, because we have, inshallah, 15 minutes for the Q&A session, is death is going to come, ikhwani, and we don't know when and where for the most part. So therefore, we should try to do our best to make preparations to die. You young people, in our city of Birmingham right now, there's a student of mine, his name is Ahmed Iqbal. His father, his family is from Ahlul Hadith. He was diligent and he was studious. Only a few months ago, he was diagnosed with a disease called lupus, 19 years old, lupus. A week and a half ago, his vital organs shut down. They put him on life support system. Problem with lupus is that the disease attacks the vital organs. It's against your immune system. This man, I have a cold, his immune system stops him from getting sick by Allah's permission. That immune system is going to protect him from my sickness by Allah's permission. Now with this young boy, Ahmed, this young boy, because he's young, the older you get, the weaker your immune system becomes. So if someone is old, they can manage lupus. Because immune system won't be attacked like that easy. His immune system won't attack the body. All right. But in the case of this young brother, he's young, viral. And the disease, his youth goes against him in this case. His immune system is strong, so it's killing him at Alalo's best. He went from 70% to 2%, and now he went back up, and I think that they said he's 20% now, up, down, up, down. May Allah give Ahmed Shifa, and the rest of the sick relatives that we have, may Allah give them all Shifa. And if he causes any of them to die, then cause them to die in Tawheed, and to make us patient with their situation. Point is, 19 years old. So death can come at any moment. It's not acceptable for a young person to say, I'm gonna live until I'm 80. I'll make Tawbah when I'm 40. I'll go to Hajj when I'm 40, when I get married. You have to, right now, make Tawbah. كُن فِي الدُّنْيَا كَعَابِرِ السَّبِيلِ Another hadith, كَأَنَّكَ غَرِيبٍ Be in the dunya as if you are a stranger. Hadith said, if you wake up in the morning, don't act as if you're gonna live to the night. And if you see the night, don't act like you're gonna wake up in the morning. If we didn't think we were gonna wake up in the morning, we will go to bed with wudu. Something simple. Just pray one rak'ah in the masjid for witr. Just one. Just one rak'ah. No, we think we're gonna get a long time. We think there's gonna be another Ramadan. اتبعوا أحسن ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم من قبل أن يأتيكم العذاب بغتة وأنتم لا تشعرون. Follow the best of what was revealed to you before the punishment comes to you from your Lord, and you're not ready for it. It just comes like that. And that's what the companions used to do. The Nabi said, it is not permissible for a man who believes in Allah in the last day to go to sleep in 3 days, for 3 days, except that his wasiyah is written with him. The wasiyah, his will. You ask the average person, do you have a will? No, I don't have a will. Abdullah ibn Umar said, when I heard that hadith, right away I wrote my will. I used to keep it under my pillow, I would go to sleep, it's with me. What's the will? I don't have any money. The will is not just how much money you have. The will, the wasiyah, is for you to tell your children and your wife after you, when I die, do my janazah like this and like this, and let so-and-so pray over me. If I die, when I die, I owe him money, pay it off. If I die, these books in this corner of my library, these books in the red section, with the red section, those are the books of the deviants in Islam. I only had those books, I only had them for references. If any of you kids read that and go astray, I'm free from you. Don't read that and blame it on me. If I die, don't go crazy and screaming, because if you go crazy and screaming, I'm gonna be punished because of the craziness and screaming. Lastly, ikhwani, if we know that death is going to come or could come anytime, we have to make islah and peace with the people we have problems with. We have some serious problems with our relatives. The auntie, the cousin, the wife, the husband, the ex-wife, ex-husband. Our community has some serious problems with our relatives. One of the worst feelings and experiences is to have a problem with a relative, and then that person dies, and then you realize, wow, it wasn't worth all of that. They're gone now. I don't get a chance to say, I'm sorry. I don't get a chance to make peace. And other than that, from those issues, other than what we have mentioned, there are some other issues, inshallah, Azza wa Jalla. Hopefully they'll come up during the Q&A session. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by his ism al-Azam, when the angel of death comes to us, inshallah, that he doesn't take our soul, except that he takes it with ease, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be pleased with all of us. Amen.